This is the 2003 Toyota Echo. In 2005, Toyota stopped making this car and then rolled out the Toyota Yaris. I can't imagine what the Yaris has that the Echo doesn't have, except for power steering, automatic windows, and power locks.
Still, the Toyota Echo's 1.5-liter engine boasts 108 horsepower, with fuel economy between 34 and 41 miles per gallon. Also, we had sex in it. Once.
Frank Garcia Hejl is a writer, teacher, and improviser at Upright Citizens Brigade.
His team Bucky performs at UCB East every Friday night, and he's a member of the award-winning sketch group Onassis.
He also does a real bitchin' Seth Rogen impression.
Hello?
Hey, Frank.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, it's Kristen and Jason. How's it going?
What?
I don't think we get good reception on the Upper West Side.
Yeah.
Do you guys not have... Okay, cool. Hey, we wanted to know if you wanted to come get some coffee with us.
Sure.
Okay, cool. Come on down. We're so close to your apartment. It's creepy. Okay, cool. See you soon. Bye. Oh, wait. Don't die yet. Oh, he did it. Good.
Okay.
We're off to a good start. So how are you doing?
I'm doing well.
It's an early Saturday morning.
Yes, it is.
Thank you for coming out.
Of course.
I see you have gelled your hair.
It's not gel, it's pomade.
That's right. A classic.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Well, thank you for going to that. So we're going to Aroma Coffee.
Great.
This will be fun, and we'll have a cup of coffee. Do you like coffee?
I do. I mean, I usually have just a small black with three sugars.
Oh,
really?
You like it
four,
sweet.
And now I'm cutting down.
It sounds like you're making a lot of healthy changes.
Yeah, I'm trying to.
It's good.
I'm trying to be a better person.
That's great.
When did you officially move to New York City and start up at UCB?
I moved up here January 2007. And I started a UCB class, I think, right away. I think that February.
Really?
It was Sketch 101 with Curtis Gwynn.
Nice.
Wow. Who's now a writer on Walking Dead.
Yes.
Amazing.
Yeah, and he was incredible because he took to me right away and kind of...
That really helps.
Yeah.
I feel like you need someone in your corner sometimes.
Exactly, yeah.
Especially when you're
excited. I wasn't doing anything great or anything, but I guess there was something about... He saw something in me that he was like,
that guy. Is that a great parking space that we passed?
Well, we're nowhere near the coffee place. So, how long have you lived up in this area?
Since November.
Since November.
Yeah, I moved in with my girlfriend. She had already lived there, and we moved in.
How's it going?
Great.
Good. That's good to hear. It's a great neighborhood up here, man.
Yeah, it was quite a change. I lived in Greenpoint for 6.5 years.
Okay.
Greenpoint, Brooklyn.
Yeah.
And it was time for a change.
It was just a little too cool.
Rates started going up.
Yeah.
I mean, now there's really no difference in the...
That's crazy.
Rent.
So we're going to Aroma Cafe. Do you ever go to Aroma?
No.
Okay.
I've never been to Aroma Cafe.
It's Aroma Espresso Bar.
Oh, espresso. So, yeah, I'm not much of a...
You like simple?
Yeah, I'm pretty simple.
All right, time
pretty
order.
Simple.
I get it.
I'm a simple man.
We're here at Aroma Espresso Bar on 72nd.
Got your host voice on.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of like a Dick Cavett set here. It's nice.
And I'm your John Lennon, right?
Yeah.
Just like Lennon.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah. So you've never been here?
No.
But it's really close to your place.
Yeah, I've lived in this area since November.
Right.
And this is my first time.
Good. Yeah, I'm glad that we got to introduce you to something new.
Yeah.
Killer food, too.
This little hole-in-the-wall mom-and-pop organization.
Yeah. I know. It's
a great place. They can really use us.
Yeah. No, it's fantastic.
So,
One of my favorite stories, and I've seen posted on your Facebook wall, mm-hmm. I mentioned a few times, is...
From stalking.
You visited from complete stalking online, like, what's Frank doing today? And I do it in that voice. But before you moved to New York, you actually came as a fan to UCB.
Yeah.
What was that like for you? And like looking back on that now, where you are with UCB, you know, the two contrasts between.
I came up kind of on a whim. I was already doing sketch and improv at a place called 4 Day Weekend Theater in Fort Worth, Texas.
Okay. Cool.
And then I
I wanted to come to UCB a lot sooner.
Right.
Just because I was a fan of the show and I knew I wanted to do it. But then I had friends that I did stuff with that wanted to do Second City, and they had already moved up and started doing Second City, and then I was going to join them, and then my friend Vanessa was like, hey, there's some cheap tickets to New York, a bunch of us are going, do you want in on this?
Right.
And I was like, yes, as long as we can go to UCB.
Yeah.
And so we were on the plane, and she's like, oh, by the way, I signed you up for this this sketch show, you have to do it. And I was like, freaked out. She's like, you have to write a sketch right now. So on the plane,
really?
I wrote this.
What was that?
I wrote this sketch, this talk show, really bad talk show parody sketch.
Right.
And we get there and I find out it's Liquid Courage.
Oh, wow.
And she had tricked me into, and I was like really nervous and I was like, no. And she's like, no, just do it. And so we're in the green room and I'm just like in awe.
Oh.
You know, just being like, oh my God, and I get to perform on the stage. My friends forgot all the lines. It was awful. It was really bad, but I was like, I didn't care.
Yeah.
It was just like, wow, I'm on the stage.
Yeah, that's huge.
And it just felt like, right. It felt like home.
Right.
And so then I was just like, that's it. It's like, I'm going to move here. This was in 2006, 2005. And,
right.
And then on January, I graduated in December of 2006. Mm-hmm. And the day I graduated, I signed up for my first class at UCB. And I was like, all right, I have to move now.
That's so interesting. I'm a little jealous of anyone who like knew exactly what they wanted to do before.
I'm not good at anything else, so it was kind of my default. Like I just kind of
had
to, like
this is what
I
it
like,
is.
Yeah, so I have a bachelor's degree in sociology and English.
Okay.
And
wow,
I'm not going to do anything with it.
When you were getting that degree, what did you think you would do? With
what
that
was
degree?
Going through your mind?
I was like, I gotta finish college.
Right. When you sit down to start to learn a character that you're going to impersonate, mm-hmm. like, what is your process for that?
For the impression, usually I stumble in it.
Really?
Usually I don't try to. What happened? The first time I ever kind of found that I could do impressions was me and Dom and I used to be on Iron Ruckus together, and we'd be at McManus drunk.
Yeah.
And we'd try to do, because he can do really great, like, walking and stuff.
Yeah.
And we'd be drunk, and we'd be like, we just, like, label celebrities to each other, and we'd go. And that's how I figured out, like, Vince Vaughn and Orson Welles and stuff like that. That's where, like, I kind of, like, discovered, oh, I can do this. And it's, like, usually it's just, like, mimicking I'm a big fan of voiceover artists and mm-hmm. stuff like that, and they always talk about, like, musicality and finding a tone, and, like, it is musical. And also, like, kind of really using your body, even though you're just doing it with the voice, of using your body in order to, you know, find it.
Right.
For, like, you know, like, the Dan Aykroyd impression, it's very much, like, in the throat, you know, like, in that area. It just, like, kind of back here. Same with, like, with Vince Vaughn, you know, it's like, you know, there's something stuck in the throat, you know, and it's like a lot, you know, they kind of just, you know, rattling off, you know, just, you know, it's like that kind of, you know.
It's the change that you have to make.
It's in here, it's all in here and in here.
Right.
It's like that, and then, like, I remember reading this thing that Daryl Hammond talked about, that he sees colors for, like, the color tones.
Really?
For, like, the people he does impressions of. And
yeah.
So I kind of, like, look at it that way, too. But there's some that I've, like, tried and just can't. Like, I just can't. I think right now I am working on one that I just kind of did as on a whim. But basically it's Fat Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Are you able to give a little?
No, I can't.
Do you do the smug face?
Well, that's the thing. It's like every time he's on, if you ever see him, like, looking on the thing, he's just so, like, he's always doing
that.
Yeah,
he's very happy with himself.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you, I want to talk about how you used to be a radio DJ, because mm-hmm. we have that in common, not me, but Jason.
Oh, really? Yeah. You were in college radio.
Yeah, so I was doing radio, television, and film for a while, mm-hmm. and then there I started DJing as, like, you know, one of the shifts at the jazz station, and I was like, this campus seems like an indie alternative show.
Right.
And they didn't want one. They definitely didn't want one, but they put it in front of a panel of people, and they're like, yeah, this is great. We should
have
it.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So for about 3 years, I had it, but I kept looking for excuses to, like, get rid of it. And then one night, I played this song, this request. I didn't even check it, because this guy, like, always requested stuff. And
right.
I didn't even check it, and it had, like, an F-bomb in it. And like, but, like, it's Safe Harbor. It was at Safe Harbor, and, like, it's a college station.
Yeah.
Nobody complained. Nobody cares.
Yeah.
But they were like, that's it. And they fired me. And I, in the Dallas Observer, I got Best Fired DJ
that year.
And then,
that's that's a heartbreaker.
But from that, I started putting together comedy and music shows called Mixtapes and Baby Fights, which I would invite bands to play and have comedians. It was kind of like a comedian to comedy type.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah, so I would have like, stand up and like bands and sketches and stuff like that. And it was like kind of my way of being like, this is what I want to do.
I mean, it's taken years and you've put in so much work and you've grown. But in January, you got to sit in with ASCAP.
Yeah.
So how's it going? Really, what was it like?
It was great. Really? I was very nervous. I've sat in a couple of times. Yeah. I'm like very low on the, you know, like I occasionally get to sit in. But that day, it was the first Sunday in January. Mm-hmm. And I was just hanging out watching it. And Neil Casey asked me, he's like, do you want to sit in? I was like, yeah. So it was Neil Casey. Oh, I went backstage and I was like already nervous. Yeah. It was like the second half, not the 7:30, but the 9:30.
Okay.
Right. And I was already nervous, and then Pete Gross and John Lutz show up.
Oh my gosh.
and then Tammy Sager was there, Shannon, Neil, Tamanik, and
huge.
I'm trying to think of who else. Tim Robinson from SNL.
Whoa.
It was
amazing.
Yeah, he's incredible. So there was a lot of like, and then me, Dan Black, you know, and then me.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So I was just like, kind of like, oh my God, what is this? What's happening? And that was the first show that I saw, other than Liquid Courage, that was the first show I saw at UCB. And remember being like, man, if only, you know, like I could be on that stage. So it was awesome. It was a really great experience for me.
You started teaching fairly recently. It's about over a year now. Right?
Oh yeah, about a year and a half. Yeah.
How has that change been for you?
We were in your audition.
Yeah, that's
we,
right.
We were in your audition.
My
group,
sketch audition. Yeah.
With Will Hines sitting in the back. Mm-hmm. You know,
you were great.
And it was great.
Thanks.
It was awesome.
It's been great. I really love it. I teach improv and sketch, and. Yeah, it's just fun to, like, be able to shape people's, like, kind of introduce them, and, like, especially with 101 students and stuff. And then even with, like, 301, having them put up a show, a sketch show, it's really incredible to see, like, I forget what that experience is like for the first time to see actors reading your words.
Right.
The process of putting a show together and being stressed out, but being like, oh, that happened.
Yeah.
Even when the show's not that great, they're just like, whoa.
That was amazing.
Yeah. So it's like, I love being a part of that, and I love, like, helping that out. And I like to, I like answering questions, too, because if students have questions, I think it's important for you to, like, answer those questions. I think as a student, though, you should be watch out for, like, overdoing it.
Right.
But I think there's a healthy amount of, like, you should ask questions. Because if you want to know how the theater works, or you want to know how, like, submitting a packet or how you even do that, like, works, it's like, ask.
And a lot of people, are scared to ask questions about things like that.
That's another thing I learned within the past year is, like, if you want something or you're curious about something, just ask.
Because,
like, you never know.
Well, you told us, I guess the fun part, you told us that the place that you want to go in New York that you haven't been yet is Peter Luger.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
We've got something that's pretty much like Peter Luger.
I mean, I guess you could say it's like the second best.
Yeah.
Because it's hard to get reservations for Peter Luger.
They were completely full up today.
And we couldn't have afforded it if we wanted to.
Right,
it's
four comedians. Called four comedians.
Yeah.
So. There's a reason.
Yeah.
But this place will be super exciting, and it's legendary.
Okay.
I think when people ask you after this experience, like, hey, where do I get a great steak in New York City?
You'll know this place.
You're going to say this place.
This is really hard. I don't want
to... God, there's so many great decisions.
So which one are you going to do?
Yeah, which number? Pick your poison.
I guess. Well, you're pork meat, so I don't want to buy too much.
Do I know?
I don't want to break your bank.
We can do this. Why we came here.
Anything you want, we got it.
What we're going to do is we're going to put on a credit card and we'll pay it off.
Eventually.
I see. Thanks for taking me here.
Of course.
This is great. This is
it was well within our budget.
Look at the seating.
There's so many seats. I know there's like a lot of seats. Thank you for picking right beside the bathroom.
Oh, wow.
I didn't. Well.
Did you do that on purpose?
You never know what's going to happen.
That is true.
So it's better to be prepared.
You never know what's going to happen.
Look at this.
I know it's wine and a saran wrap.
Yeah. Let's think ahead. I'm not going to spill this on anybody.
Up.
Can't wait for that. You can't wait for your turn. Are you gonna tell your mom about this?
Probably not.
And your family down in Texas?
Probably not.